Wow, just think of the excitement. We got the kids up here, and I think Pamela's going to be doing something special with them tonight, and so they're excited about that. Youth, I know Mr. David said to stay in here until after business meeting, but you guys are dismissed when we get done tonight, and you all can go ahead and go do your thing while we're doing business meeting, okay? So just go with Mr. David for that. Also, yeah, we do have business meeting tonight. And then Wednesday night, we'll be having a men's Bible study at 5:30. They're studying the book of Romans, and I think James Randall is doing that study for them. And then EBC Kids at 6, and the student ministry at 6, and then we'll be doing mission study this Wednesday night instead of the winter Bible study. And then you got choir practice at 7:30, and then the youth will be leaving. What time y'all leaving Friday?
We are leaving the church property at 12:40.
12:40 to go to Gatlinburg for the resurrection. So make sure you get all your papers in and everything. Got some things for to give in.
I got them all in. If teenagers, if you are not going to school, you have to be here by 12:30 because we have to load everything. So no later than 12:30 here. Otherwise, we'll pick you up at 1 at the schools.
Okay, good, good. And I want you all to know, David Kearns, he has filled up 3 of these baby bottles already, so we got to get on the stick to try to keep up with him. So he was so excited to take them to Debbie this afternoon, and so don't forget the baby bottles. If you've not picked one of those up, pick that up, and that's just filled up with change. Yes, money, yeah, Mark's going to start singing for us, but fill that up, and that will help the ministry at the Women's Care Center, okay? Anything else we need to mention? Okay, if not, Dave, lead us in worship.
Good evening. Good evening. Would you stand up and sing with me at the cross? Alas, and did my Savior bleed and such as I. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done? Says that he created us to praise him, created us to worship him, and it goes on to say that if my people won't, that the rocks will cry out. I don't want the rocks to cry out. I want to sing God's praise. I want you to know, about 5 years ago, I read a study. The scientists just figured out that the earth sings. The earth emits a hum that is a musical pitch, and I'm going, hey, God created everything that is, and every planet, they say, has this pitch, these pitches. So the universe sings his praises, but I, as a sentient being, as somebody who understands what I'm doing, I want to sing his praises more. So shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Don't be wimpy about your praise. Have a blast doing it and shout to the Lord. Nothing compares. Thank you. You can have a seat. The next song says, "Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? He is the counselor, he's the comforter, and he's the one that we praise tonight." Counselor, comforter, king. Doesn't matter what you've been through in your life. It doesn't matter what you're going through in your life. God says, I can take care of it. He says, I knew who you were before you were formed in your mother's womb, and I knew who you were at the foundations of the earth when they were laid. I knew who you were going to be, and I knew everything about you, and I still loved you, and I still came and died for you. I have a maker, and he formed my heart, and he knows my name. Imagine that. I know there were times when I yelled for my dad, and he never answered me, not because he wouldn't, but just because he wasn't within hearing distance. And my God says, hey, I hear every time you call. I know every time you shed a tear, and I'll be there for you. It's His grace, His redeeming love that He's given us free. And His grace is greater than any sin that we could ever participate in.
Marvelous infinite matchless grace that exceeds our sin. Measured up by depth and girth, the Father says, now what's He worth? May He see Jesus' death and birth. Don't measure me by dollar signs or bricks and mortar you may find. By Christ alone will I be found.
not worthy of that golden crown. Worthy of that golden crown. The value of this life I've lived. How did I love, did I forgive? Where did my treasure truly lay? How did I start and end each day? Don't measure me by battles won or some good deed that I have done. By Christ alone will I be found worthy of that golden crown. Worthy of that golden crown. Maybe a pauper or a king, have nothing or have everything. The question begs, do you belong? Do you sing a resurrection song? Measured by the Master's hand, on only one truth can we stand. By Christ alone will we be found worthy of that golden crown. Worthy of that golden crown.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Shannon. Wow, that is beautiful. Hey, if you would, turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, or 1 Corinthians chapter 12, okay? And like I said this morning, the next few Sunday nights, we're going to be talking about Christian community. And teenagers, let me encourage you, this message tonight, the next few messages, let God speak to your heart. And I think this is one of the most important decisions you're going to make within your life. You know, after you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, make sure that you stay a part of the body of Christ. And so these are some important messages to you. We'll be looking at some of the one another statements in the New Testament. We're told as God's family, we're to love and forgive one another. We're to serve and submit to one another. We're to encourage one another. We're to be devoted to one another. And with that, you know, it's pretty obvious that no man is an island. I like the song by 10th Avenue North. It's got a nice chorus to it. It says, no man is an island, we can be found. No man is an island, let your guard down. You don't have to fight me, I am for you. We're not meant to live this life alone. That we're to live in Christian community. I think that we all can agree that we live in a fast-paced society, often an efficient society, but sometimes not a relational society. You know, we set up for isolation. We wear our little earbuds when we're doing exercise. We communicate by email or text messages because that's just faster than actually having a conversation with someone. There's gated communities, and you can drive in your little garage without getting out of your car. And perhaps all societies are like that, and that's why God tells us over and over with the one another statements that I am not, you are not an island, that we need one another. You know, too many husbands are content perhaps to escape to their little man cave when their families are relationally starving for a relationship. Many people appear gracious and kind, but they live for their own pleasure. Many people, you know, boast of Facebook friends, but have no real face-to-face friends. I heard a very sad story about someone being asked on one of the radio programs about his elderly parents. And he said his dad was at that stage in his life that he is kind of withdrawn into himself and no longer talks a lot. And I thought, how sad that is. And yet we can sometimes live that way, just drawing to ourselves, selfishly making everything about us. Well, God doesn't want us to live secluded, solitary lives. We're to be a part of a Christian community. And so this passage of Scripture we're going to read in just a few minutes is the greatest passage that shows us how much we need one another. And so God wants us to be a crutch for each other, or perhaps better yet, interdependent upon each other. God created us for one another. So won't we stand 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And let's just read through this text. Let's begin there in verse 12 tonight, okay? It says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all of the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been made all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, 'Because I am not the hand, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, 'Because I am not the eye, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, each one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, but yet one body." Verse 21. "And the eye cannot say unto the hand, 'I have no need of thee,' nor again the head to the feet, 'I have no need of you.' Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary, and those members of the body which are weak to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our comely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, no division, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And whether one member suffer, all the members shall suffer with it, or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ." Let us pray. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this opportunity to come out and to worship and praise your holy and precious name. And Lord, I just praise you. I thank you so much for all the kids here tonight. And that, Lord, I just pray that you would just bless them. I thank you so much for the teenagers here tonight. And Lord, I just pray and that, Lord, they get everything off their mind. And Lord, that you just be able to speak to their hearts about what it means to be part of the family of God, what it means to take responsibility for our church. And so, Lord, just speak to their hearts tonight. And then, Lord, I just pray for every adult here tonight, that, Lord, if we claim to be a member of Eatonville Baptist Church, let's just realize what a wonderful privilege that is, what a wonderful honor that is, being a member here and being how we need one another and how we minister to one another, how we're to build each other up and encourage one another so that we can be the light, that we can be the salt that you called us to be in this dark generation that we live. And so, Lord, right now, just take this time and Lord, just reach into our hearts and may your Holy Spirit lead and direct us. And when we leave this place, may we understand better what it means to be part of your family. And may we rejoice in that. And Lord, may you just make us even more committed. And we'll give you the glory for all things. Amen. Amen. Well, that passage of Scripture tells us that as God's family, we belong to each other and we need each other. One reason that Jesus established his church was so we wouldn't have to live in isolation. It's obvious that the church is a living fellowship in which we worship the Lord. We're to be united in Christ. We're to witness of his grace and we're to encourage one another in this truth. And so let's just notice how we are connected to each other as the body of Christ. First, just notice we're connected by our different gifts. And the gifts that Jesus Christ has given us, they help us to live and grow. They help us to serve. Look there at verse 14. Let's read from there. "For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, 'Because I am not the hand, I am not of the body,' it is therefore not of the body. And if the ear shall say, 'Because I am not the eye, am I not of the body?' it is therefore not of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, yet but one body." Listen, no member of this church has the right to compare or contrast himself with another member, because each of us are different from one another. Each of us is important to one another. You know, I could possibly learn to walk on my hands, but it'd be a whole lot easier to let my feet do the walking and my hands do what God created them to do. You know, my ears cannot see, my eyes cannot hear, yet each are important. And without every part of the body, then we become handicapped. And there is no place of jealousy. There's no place of envy within the church. The Lord has given each of his different gifts, each of his the ministries, and we are all needed to accomplish God's will, to accomplish God's purpose he has for us here in this valley. The Lord has called me and others to preach and to teach from his word, and others he's called to sing, maybe do administrative gifts, dramas, outreach. That list is just simply endless. God has given a multitude of gifts to this church, and yet many churches, you know, kind of get by with just one or two of their gifts. You know, let's just utilize the gift of teaching. Let's just utilize the gift of preaching. But many of the other gifts just go unused in the pew. Oh, how it must disappoint our Heavenly Father who has given us a blank check for every gift available, and yet we don't use them. Listen, the church isn't a one-man or wasn't a one-woman show. It's not like a one-trick pony. It's every member doing the work that God has gifted them to do. It's every member in this church. Listen, they're important for God's work to get done. You know, some people feel if their gifts do not put them in the limelight, well, that's my gift's not that important. That's not really needed. Listen, that's simply not true. Every person in this church, from custodian to preacher, from song director to the nursery worker, from Sunday school teachers to the deacons, from ushers to the youth workers, they are all important to the health of the body of Christ. Amen. And notice there, did you notice there in verse 18, the Lord is sovereign in giving these gifts. But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. And listen, and God doesn't make mistakes. Listen, they all are needed in the body. Now, of course, that means to be used of God, we must first be a part of the body of Christ. You know, I've visited people who claim to be Christians, but they don't attend church anywhere. And they'll make kind of excuses like, well, you know, someone really hurt me hard. I don't want to be set up for again like that. And or perhaps they'll say that, well, I'm kind of a loner and I really don't need these people to serve God. Well, guess what? Those people are wrong. They're simply wrong. If they truly are Christians, they belong to the church, whether they acknowledge it or not. You cannot be a Christian and not be a part of the body of Christ. To be a Christian and not be actively involved in a church or the body of Christ, it was not even an issue in the early church. You know, as we read this scripture right here, the Bible takes for granted if you are a Christian, you will be a part of his church. Amen. How could you be a foot? How could you be an eye or a mouth? How could you be a hand if you do not belong to a church? And so if you claim to be a Christian and don't go to church, you're on shaky ground. You need to search your heart to make sure that you're really saved. Another excuse I'll hear, well, I'm not going down to that church because, you know, that there's some hypocrites there. And they may be some church hypocrites. I don't know of any within our church. But listen, that's still not a justifiable excuse for not coming to church. Jesus said there will be wheat and tares in the visible church. And God's word says there's going to be hypocrites at times in the church until he returns to judge them. He actually tells us we're not even to root them up at this time in history. You know what else? I think that, you know, from scripture it's pretty clear. As you look at the other churches and the difficulty and problems they had, that there's always going to be problems within the church. But you know, that's okay because the Bible tells us how to handle those problems. But if the members of the body, if they don't show up, then there cannot be a church. Then there's not a body of Christ. You know, I believe this whole illustration of the body, it teaches there is no excuse for not being actively involved in the local church. Now, you may offend me in some way. Sometimes I might make you angry in some way. Listen, but we are not to quit coming to church. We're to work those problems out for the glory of God. We're to work those problems out for the sake of our community, the lost, because by our love, by our unity, they will know that we belong to Jesus Christ. You know, we're not like some churches that teach if you don't belong to their particular church, you're going to die and go to hell. But I would say that you better belong to some church or you need to check your salvation. Listen, the Holy Spirit baptizes into Christ's body when we were saved and we become a member of God's family. We are one in the Spirit of God. If you're truly saved, you will become a new creation in Christ. The Holy Spirit now indwells you. You will start displaying the fruit of the Spirit. You start displaying the, you know, love and joy and your peace and long-suffering and patience and so on. And you will naturally have a desire to fellowship with God's people once you've given your life to Christ. You want to use the spiritual gift that God has given you to build up and edify the body of Christ. You want to tell others about Jesus Christ and be involved in a church that's trying to accomplish the great commission of evangelism. You want to disciple those who are saved. You will desire to come and worship God within His church. And how on God's green earth can you do all of those different things if you're not involved in the church? You simply can't. You can't do that. Now, teenagers, I was thinking about this in the afternoon. I could never understand how teenagers or young adults can be kind of like dropout Christians. Listen, when I was a teenager, my dad quit going to church for a while. And he got angry about something and or whatever. Listen, that was not an excuse for me to quit going. I remember when I moved away from home and went off to college, and the people I was living with, they didn't go to church. But listen, that was not an excuse for me not to come to church. As a young married couple, you know, Brenda and I, we didn't discuss, well, you think we need to go to church today? Listen, we were Christians. We're a part of the body of Christ. That was not an option for us not to come to church. Christian fellowship with one another. We're to worship. We serve our God together within His church. Remember when Saul encountered Jesus Christ on the Damascus Road? Jesus asked him, you know, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And how was he persecuting Jesus? He was persecuting Christ's people. He was persecuting the church. And you may be thinking, well, Brian, man, yes, it sounds a little legalistic. It's not legalistic. I'm saying once you are born again, you can't stay away from the church. You can't stay away from the body of Christ because the Holy Spirit draws us into fellowship, into community with one another. Years ago, I remember watching a movie called 61, and it was about Mickey Mantle and Roger Maris, who played for the Yankees in 1961. That year, Roger Maris broke Babe Ruth's home run record. But in that movie, they kept saying a line over and over again, and it referred to the Yankee Stadium. And he said, "This is the house that Ruth built." That made that stadium a special place for baseball fans. Well, folks, listen, the church is the house that Jesus Christ built by shedding His blood on the cross for my sins and for your sins. Amen? Amen. And if Babe Ruth's house can draw thousands of baseball fans to go, you know, watch a sporting event, how many Christians should the church draw since it is the house that Jesus Christ built? It wasn't built by hitting a little baseball over a fence, but by the dying on the cross for our sins. And if you're a fan of Jesus Christ, you will want to be a part of His church. You want to be a part of His house, a part of His family. We are the body of Christ. He says, how can a hand separate itself from an arm? How could the foot ever separate itself from a leg without dying? It simply can't. We have got to be a part of one another's lives. Andrew Carnegie was asked one time what was the most important, labor, capital, or brains. And he simply answered, you know, what is the most important of a leg of a three-legged stool? Listen, each member of this church, it's vital. You're important to this ministry that God has called us to. We cannot function properly without one another. So we're connected by our gifts. And then second, just notice here, we're connected by our dependence upon one another. Look now at verse 21 through 26. He says, "And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness.
For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which is lacked. That there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all members rejoice with it. And each member of this church needs one another. We cannot afford to be independent. When a part of the family, the human body is independent, listen, you got a serious problem. They call that cancer. They call that a sickness. It leads to death. A healthy body is one where all the members are working together, doing what they've been created to do. And when that happens, there's no division within the body. That each member of the body is important. We're vital to the body. Listen, I was thinking, listen, I want my kids, I want my grandkids to know that they're as good as anybody else in the world. They are not to measure their self-worth by how much money they have or don't have, by the clothes that they wear, by how smart or how good-looking they are, but that they have been made in God's image, and Jesus Christ loved them so much he died for them up on the cross. Amen. They're as good as anybody. And listen, we need to say that to each other in the body, that you're good as anybody. Jesus, though, of course, has a different standard for greatness than what we do. In Mark 9, verse 33, we're told, when Jesus came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, "What was it that you disputed among yourselves by the way?" He's talking to the disciples. But they held their peace, for by the way, they had disputed among themselves who should be the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12 and said unto them, "If any man desire to be first or great, the same shall be last of all and servant to all." Now you may think that you're high and mighty because of the position you hold at work. Maybe because, you know, your name stands out in the community. Maybe even what you do within the church. But if you don't treat people under you with respect, if you don't treat them with dignity and love, you're nothing at all. We're equal in Christ. We're not to treat anyone different because of some superficial differences. When we start distinguishing between rich and poor and the high and the low and the racial differences in this church, listen, we might as well shut the church because we cease to be the body of Christ. Amen. We're never to treat others as if they're inferior. Oh, how heartbreaking to hear someone dishonor a person because that they're from a different race or from a different economic group. There is no place for racial prejudice within the body of Christ. All men are to be treated with honor. All men are to be treated with respect, especially in the church of Jesus Christ. Amen. Folks, heaven is going to be made up of blacks and whites and Indians and Orientals and Spanish and Donna, even Melungeons from Virginia is going to be there. Amen. We were created by God in his image, and we're to treat each other with respect and love and dignity. We're Christ's body, so we're to act with love as Jesus Christ acted and how he loved, and he loved everyone. Someone has written, "He has no hands but our hands to do his work today. He has no feet but our feet to lead men in his way. He has no voice but our voice to tell men how he died. He has no help but our help to lead them to his side." We become a part of the body of Christ, so connected that he says in verse 26, "And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. And one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it." Folks, that's family. We're connected by our different spiritual gifts. We're connected by our dependency upon one another. And then the last thing, notice here, we're connected by our goal to fulfill the will of God. Notice in verse 27, he says, "Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondly prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, and governments, and diversities of tongues. All are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles. have all the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret, but covet earnestly the best gifts. Listen, it is God who bestows the gifts and assigns the offices within the church. He has a perfect plan for his church, and he has a perfect plan for our church. God has placed within our church the gifts that we need to accomplish his will and his purpose for us. And that connects us, that unites us. Again, he's saying each gift is important, and each individual believer is important. And if you don't know your spiritual gift, I think Charlie York had given a spiritual inventory to his class, and maybe Chuck, your all's class took that. And you need to figure that out, and then use that gifts for that is where our joy comes in. That's where the purpose of our Christian life comes from. I took the inventory. He'd sent it to my email. And my gifts came out pastor and service and faith. And I thought, man, I am so glad that did. I was going to be looking for another job if it come out for something else. But, you know, I enjoy my life. It's been made so meaningful by pastoring and preaching and teaching God's word within our church, by serving our church. And over the years, my faith and my trust in God has grown. I know that God is sovereign. He loves me. And whatever happens, I can have peace in that, knowing that he will use that for my good. He'll use that for his glory. All we're to rejoice in using the gifts that God has given us and not judge those as inferior because they have different gifts than we do. He said, no gift is greater. No gift is better than the others. But he does say, now, I like this. Notice this phrase right here. He says that we're to desire the higher gift. And I think that what he's saying there, he's saying that be as great as you can. Whatever gift God gives you, use it to the max. Do the best you can with that gift. Allow the Holy Spirit to develop that gift as great as he can. In the book Safely Home, Christians are not allowed to do the best jobs in China. And there was this highly educated Christian. He taught within the university, but because he was a Christian, the government made him a street sweeper. And that's the lowest, that's the most humble job in that society. But the Christian didn't complain. He became the best street cleaner in all of China. Listen, we are to call each other to greatness. Be the best, you know, nursery worker. Be that best Sunday school teacher. Be the best deacon. Be the best pastor that you can be for the glory of God. Amen. The Christian faith is not just a series of don'ts. It's a call to greatness. We're to be a great church in Dunlap. Jay Kessler said, you know, if the Christian faith is just a series of don'ts, the best Christian in my household is my pet dog. That's not true in our household. Our dog don't listen to anything. But listen, we're called to greatness. We're called to greatness in our service and our love and our giving and dying to self and in serving one another. The Christian faith takes a group of unhappy, ineffective, lazy, unknown pagans and make them the strongest army on the face of this earth. And folks, anything less than that is not Christian. Anything less than that is an affront to God's word and Jesus' death and the power of the Holy Spirit to change us and make us different. It'll be all that we can be in this church. Be the greatest servant that you can be. Now, I really pray one day that God will say, Brian, man, you were faithful to the gifts that I've given you and the power I gave it to you to serve that through my grace and through my spirit. You did the best you could to preach and to serve that church. You used those gifts to the max. That should be all of our desire. Like I said, to be the best deacon, be the best Sunday school teacher, be the best usher, be that best witness, be the best janitor, the best of whatever God gifts us with. And teenager, you know, be the best student you can be in that school. And you should study and make the best grades that you could make. Use the gifts and begin to develop them now within your life and in this church to serve. No, businessmen, you're to be the best businessmen in Dunlap. Bankers, you're to have the most integrity of all the bankers within our town. We're to be the best we can be, whatever we're doing. You know, Ootonville Baptist Church should be known as having the best workers within our community. The best teachers, the best factory workers, the best manager. We're called to greatness. And we can only accomplish that as we stay connected. We're connected by our different spiritual gifts. We're connected by our dependency upon one another. We're connected by the goal to fulfill the will of God in our community. Listen, we are the community of Christ. It means that to have in common, we share the same life. We share the same word of God. We share the same love for Jesus, the concern for the lost word, and our desire to glorify God. Next week, we'll begin with the one another statements, which is mentioned over like 40 times in the New Testament. So let's never forsake the assembling of ourselves together. And when we do, we're like lone sheep and maybe a pack of ravenous wolves ready to attack us. There's danger in being alone. Folks, the early believers knew that. So they devoted themselves, we're told, to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and the breaking of bread from house to house and prayers. You know, Solomon, you know, speaks about that threefold cord that is not quickly broken. The Christian life is not an individual sport. We're connected to one another. We're a community, and we're to share ourselves with others. And if you're here tonight and you're not a Christian, if you're not a part of the body of Christ, listen, God loves you. He loved you so much. He sent his son to die on that cross for your sins so that he could save you individually, so he could place you within his body. And as Christians, let me encourage you, never stop being a part of God's family. You're a vital part of the body. So serve the Lord with all your heart and all your strength and all of your might. Dave, come with a song of invitation. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this word that you've given us tonight. Lord, I just thank you so much again for the privilege of being a part of your family. And Lord, I just pray for each person here tonight. I know you spoke to each of our hearts, and Lord, may we respond to that right now. Lord, if that's back at our seats or that's coming forward, Lord, and getting something right with you, I just pray right now as we go into this invitation that, Lord, that we would respond to that. Lord, I just pray for each of our teenagers here that, Lord, to just be with them. And Lord, I know that the ones that belong to you, Lord, right now, just give them a deep love for your church that, Lord, would keep in their church through thick and thin, through whatever you call them and wherever you call them into the future, that Lord, that they're going to be a vital part of the church. They're going to be using their gifts, to be that light to the world, that, Lord, that we're on a mission, the greatest mission in the whole world, proclaiming the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, allow them to do that. And so, Lord, this is your time, and may we respond, and we give you the praise for it all. Amen. Won't we stand? And as God leads you, if you need to come forward tonight, won't you come?
We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh, Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Down our idols, give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. O God, let us be a generation that seeks, O God of Jacob.
Amen, amen, amen. I just pray again that God just spoke in your heart and he just gives you a deep love for his body. Ain't it wonderful to be a part of the family of God? Amen. Not anything in the world like that. And folks, let's don't ever forget that great privilege. And let us, when we go into that workplace tomorrow, wherever you may be in God takes you tomorrow, you know, let the world know, hey, being a Christian and being a part of the family of God is something so special and so wonderful and such a wonderful privilege that we want to share that with the world. Amen? Hallelujah. That's what we're to be about, okay? Well, listen, we're going to dismiss. Don't forget everything going on this week. And then we got to, and then we go into our business meeting in just a few minutes, okay? And teenagers, I think you're supposed to meet in the gym.
Straight to the gym. Straight
okay?
to the gym.
Okay. So let's see here. Well, BW, since you're up front, why don't you close us in prayer then?